I, for one, am shocked another top-ranked team was upset.
I mean, that never happens this year.
It is truly remarkable. Unranked North Carolina State upset number 6 Duke, 88-66 last night, according to ESPN Stats and Info. That game marked the first time an unranked opponent beat a top-10 Duke team by at least 20 points since 1979. Holy baseball stat. Duke couldn't stop Markell Johnson. He had 28 points for the Wolfpack, including a banked-in runner from just beyond half court to give them a 44-29 lead over Duke at the break. NC State's a bubble team for the NCAA tournament, and our own bracketology expert Joe Lenardi, after the win, moved them from the last four out column to the last team in the tournament. ESPN's Basketball Power Index also improved their chances to make the tournament from 16% to 26%. Duke, on the other side, goes from an 82% chance to just a 78% chance at getting a one seed. In the NBA, John Beilein officially moves to a new role with the Cavaliers. The Cavs announced that head coach John Beilein has resigned as head coach of the organization. The team is reassigning Beilein in his first season as the Cavs head coach to a different role, the team announced. The Cavs didn't announce what that role was with the team. Beilein reiterated in a statement that it was his decision to resign his position. He's walking away from a contract that consists of four guaranteed seasons at a salary between $4 and $4.5 million. And in the NFL, the news about the collective bargaining agreement comes with the talk of expansion. Expanded playoffs. If and when a new collective bargaining agreement is agreed and finalized, there is now mounting optimism that that could be done sometime next week. It is expected to change the NFL's playoff structure as it's currently constituted for next season, league sources tell ESPN. Under the current CBA proposal, the NFL owners are pushing for the playoff field to be expanded to 7 teams from each conference, while the regular season will be increased to 17 games per team, and the preseason will be shortened to just 3 games per team, sources said. As part of the proposed playoff format, only one team from each conference will receive a first-round bye, as opposed to the 2 that currently do, league sources said Sunday. The change to the NFL's playoff format would take effect for the 2020 season, assuming this new CBA is ratified beforehand.
Golic and Wingo with you, ESPN Radio and ESPN2, presented by Progressive Insurance. All phone guests join us on the Shell Pennzoil Performance Line. We'll have Mike Tannenbaum, our NFL front office insider here, and his napkins of off-season integrity coming up in just a little bit. So we're excited about that. But there's something else we need to talk about.
There is something else we need to talk about. What's Trending is brought to you by PXG. PXG, nobody makes golf clubs the way we do, period. That was the other thing I needed to tell you about What is Trending.
It's also because
you didn't know that.
I did.
You would know that better than most of us here, actually.
That's a fair point. So this playoff thing is out there. The CBA is potentially getting done within the next 48 hours. And the biggest change, I think, for the casual fan is going to be the idea of playoff teams going from 12 to 14 and only one team making the bye in each conference. And you brought up a really good point. This all sounds well and good. However, Kansas City was the 2 seed last year and got the bye in the last week of the season when they took care of the Chargers and then inexplicably the Dolphins and that bearded lunatic Ryan Fitzpatrick took down New England at New England in week 17, giving the Chiefs the bye. Do we think the Chiefs still would have gotten to the Super Bowl had they not had the bye?
You know what? That's hard to say, but it would have been made a lot harder and it would have opened them up to risk, right?
Right.
Like the NCAA is a lot different than this, than the NFL, because the depth of talent in the NFL, because of the amount of teams, because of the quality of the players, it's a lot more than in the NCAA. So there's a chance that that Steelers team could have found a way to beat Patrick Mahomes and the Kansas City Chiefs on one day. Now, it's highly unlikely, but it could have happened. And then what are we looking at here?
Yeah,
a playoffs without Patrick Mahomes because you wanted to
not here for that.
But I guess that's what I mean in all seriousness. Yeah. From a product standpoint, and I enjoyed that Steelers team last year for what it represented, right? What Mike Tomlin put together. But let's just use them as a proxy. Let's take the Steelers off it and say an 8-8 football team playing their backup quarterback was one that potentially upset a team with one of the faces of the league on it.
Yeah.
Just those general types. You want to open yourself up to that kind of NCAA tournament risk. I get it for the cash grab of all of it. I understand that. But from a competitive standpoint, the same reason I generally tend to be against a lot of upsets as we get into the second round of the NCAA tournament are the reason that on principle, I don't really like this move. You can call it watering down the playoff field. To me, it's opening up these good teams that we want to see play deep into the postseason to unnecessary risk.
I agree. I think that's the risk if you're a fan that you arguably throw more chance into one of the top four teams making it. Because outside of the Cowboys when they were the number one seed in 2016, since 2013, every Super Bowl has basically been a one or two seed. It's been that way. I mean, the last time there was a not one or two seed, excuse me, out there was the 2012 season when the Ravens won the whole damn thing playing on Wild Card Weekend. Other than that, it's been teams with the bye the entire time.
Yes, and so a lot of that, like I look at that and say, all right, what about the new collective bargaining agreement that went into place the year before? Maybe had an effect on that. Teams have less time to practice and prepare in the offseason and training camp, so maybe you're a little more reliant on the strength of your roster's quality than you are your ability to develop people because you just don't have as much time. But regardless, that's been what it is.
Right.
And so those advantages you're now stripping from a team in the two seed. So yeah, I get it. More teams are in it for longer. Is that really always a good thing by the end of the season? We went back and looked at the numbers in all of this. Of the teams, if you go back to 2002 and say, if we had expanded this field, who would have made the postseason in that time? There would have been 36 teams that would have been added over that time. You would have had 9 teams with double-digit wins that would have been added. So 8 10-win teams, and then the 11-win Patriot teams when Matt Castle was the quarterback in 2008. You would have had 18 9-win teams at that time, and then you would have had 9 8-win teams that would have also been a part of that. So that's what you're opening this up to, again, in my mind, in something that potentially knocks – and I don't know, maybe I'm just very, like, in general, not a big underdog guy. Like, I want to see the really good teams. We play all these teams games in the regular season to figure out who's good and who's not, and then you want to reward someone who sneaks in.
Yeah, so let's sort of go down the list here of what's at stake in this new CBA that potentially could be decided in the next 48 hours, one way or the other. I think we can all agree that less preseason games is a win, right? We understand that part of it. I think
nobody involved likes the preseason.
And I think we're also to the point where we understand, because of the way preseason has changed over the last 5 to 10 years, that really the first 2 weeks of the season are essentially warm-up games.
You could even argue the first quarter of the season, right? You see a lot of these teams figuring it the hell out.
Right. So and while sometimes that's difficult because it could cost you, because when you're trying to figure that out, there's an assignment blown and there may be someone that you really need on your team that suddenly gets injured because of that. But I think the idea of taking out the risk of something like that happening in a preseason game, I think we can all agree that's probably okay.
Yes.
Right? Because I think we're going to see more and more teams, by the way, essentially have these joint practices together and use that more as the basis of getting your team ready.
The NFL's players, you know, coaches, all these people made this decision for the league, right?
Right.
The way they decided to go about doing this basically forced their hand to say, you can have these preseason games. We're not playing anybody.
Yeah.
Like, you're going to have to force us to put bodies on the field for those games because we think we can get that value in other ways.
Right.
They made that decision for them.
So that's a win. The 17-game regular season, if you're a fan, you want that, right? You really do. If you're a fan, you want to see that. So to me, the only issue and the biggest issue going forward, should this thing be agreed on as it's being presented right now, as we understand, again, the NFL owners are meeting on this, trying to get a consensus on that. They need 3/4 of the vote. The NFLPA is going to have a conference call later on this week and update their reps, and the reps will take that to the teams, and they'll disseminate that information. Then the idea becomes, are we okay, as you alluded to, putting more chance into the postseason? And that's interesting, right? Because we all love the postseason. It's the fun. They're basically giving us the thing we want more of.
Well,
right?
Phil Yates pointed this out. We're still going to watch. Like,
yes,
of course
we're
moss to the flame on this one. That's going to happen. Mr. Christopher tweets in and said, the beauty of the playoffs in the NFL is that any given Sunday, anything can happen. I like an expanded playoffs. Also with the CBA, the players know what they're getting themselves into. Thank you for that last sentence of true enlightenment there. But with the expanded playoffs, that any given Sunday thing, I think the point we're making is, since 2012, not really.
Yeah.
Like, it's the good teams.
Correct.
Which is, again, in my mind, one of the beauties of the things that's great about the NFL is you end up crowning a true champion.
Right.
The teams that are good all along, you're not beholden to the randomness of a hot goaltender or a hot pitcher. It's you have to show all year that you are good and consistent for this to work.
Yeah. And listen, but that's the downside, right? To me, that's the one downside of this, is that the good teams, only one of those teams will be rewarded. And again, what did we have last year in the NFC? We had 3 teams that were 13-3.
Yeah.
3 teams that were 13-3, and one of them had to play on wild card weekend. This time around, there would be two. If this format had been in place, two of those teams that won 13 games would not have had the benefit of that bye.
And so I look at this and say that would be the negative on one side. The way you could potentially make this at least a little more palatable is because, you want to see that kind of stuff rewarded. You want to see going out there and accomplishing rewarded. That was our beef with the NFC East being involved in the playoffs at all this year. Is if you take those last two wild card teams and instead of adding a team from each conference, maybe you just pick the best two records at that point. Regardless of conference there, you say, we're going to take the next two best teams involved in all this instead of anything else to try and at least continue to reward people that accomplish, not just people that happen to be the next in line, even if they're not a very good team.
And that sounds wonderful. But then we're talking about, basically, are we getting rid of conference structure and division structure? And didn't the NBA contemplate that idea in trying to change their postseason? And the NBA, which is a pretty progressive league, and they're much less hard and fast with that's the way it's always been. The owners didn't like that part when it came to potential travel for the postseason, right? That sort of nixed that. I can't imagine a scenario in the NFL where they are adamant about that division title meaning something and that team getting a home playoff game, that they would go down that road. I'm not saying it's not a good idea. I just don't see how they're going to get there.
No, it's going to end up being – what's going to happen is the simplest version of all this. They're going to expand the regular season. They're going to expand the postseason, and we're all going to shut up and take it.
Right.
Like, that's going to be what happens because the NFL knows they've got us.
Right.
Like, that's it in all this.
And the other thing that needs to be driven home about this, because I do believe one of the great things about the NFL postseason is you got to earn it. I mean, like, in the NHL and in the NBA, you play 80-plus games to eliminate less than half the teams from the postseason, right? I mean, still, so many teams get into the postseason. It's still that way in the NFL, and this is why I think this is important to drive home, because this is the first playoff tweak since 2002, but that was just reassigning deck chairs. The number of chairs stayed the same. This is a significant move in adding postseason teams since 1990. The current playoff format in terms of teams that make the postseason has been in place since 1990. Why is that significant? Because in 1990, there were only 28 teams. And of those 28 teams, 12 got into the postseason. Well, now there are 32 teams. So we haven't had a jump in the terms of the number of teams that make the postseason since we've expanded by four teams. So that's why on that part of it, I'm okay with seven, because we've had four more teams in the league. So essentially, we've gone from 12 out of 28 to potentially 14 out of 32. When you look at it that way, it doesn't seem like it's that much of a watering down situation at all.
No, it doesn't. And for the NFL side, what they're going to argue is we keep more teams in it for longer, which for them and for the bottom line and for fans, like, I'm sure there are going to be fans of a lot of teams that are happy their team has a shot, happy that they get to be in it for longer, happy that those conversations get pushed back further into the regular season.
Yeah, the bottom line is, and when you say we're expanding the playoffs, it really doesn't change much because of the way this thing has been structured for so long, and I think that's important for people to understand. Coming up, the only way to clean up this mess about an expanded playoff is with Napkins of Integrity. And we're going to do that next with our next guest after SportsCenter.
Gigantic win at this stage of the season for the NCAA Jumping Hopes. And they can begin the celebration in Raleigh here this evening as they roll over the Duke Blue Devils.
Dave O'Brien on ESPN giving you the call on the upset in the world of college basketball last night. It happened again. It's been happening all season. No one should be surprised at this point. But Coach K and number 6 Duke were handed an 88-66 beatdown by unranked North Carolina State. The loss was Coach K's largest against an unranked team in his time as Duke's head coach. And it was Duke's largest loss overall since the 2013 NCAA tournament. Moving on to the NFL, news broke by our own Adam Schefter yesterday that the league is expected to change the playoff structure for the upcoming season. Under a new proposal, 7 teams from each conference would make the playoffs, and only the top seed from each conference would receive a first-round bye. Back to the hardwood, rejoice and be glad. The NBA returns from the All-Star break tonight. Some things to keep your eye on in the, air quotes, second half of the season, really the last third. The Bucks and their quest for potentially 70 wins on the season. The Lakers and Clippers continue the battle for LA. And, of course, for Zion Williamson. SportsCenter is brought to you by Pennzoil. Crude oil is crude. Natural gas is pure. That's why Pennzoil's base oil is made from natural gas, not crude. Gives you unbeatable engine protection. The proof is in the Pennzoil based on Sequence 4A wear testing using SAE 5W30.
I think Roger Goodell would like to have this deal in place at the Combine in Indianapolis next week.
It's all part of a new collective bargaining agreement.
The players get a lot more money. The NFL gets more games to sell. And basically, there's more money for everybody to go around.
All right, Golic and Wingo with you, ESPN Radio, ESPN2, presented by Progressive Insurance. All phone guests join us on the Shell Pennzoil Performance Line, but then there's our guy, Mike Tannenbaum, who joins us in studio, our NFL front office guru giving us a straight talk, brought to you by Straight Talk Wireless, everything for less, only at Walmart. There is no off-season, Mike, for the napkins of integrity. So are you ready to enlighten us with these napkins?
Yeah, the napkins have been had a little bit of a break. You know, they've been strengthened, they've been rested, they've been load managed, and they are now ready to go.
All right, so let's start the napkins of integrity with the overall thing, the CBA negotiations. It does sound like there is a realistic shot this thing could be done and signed off on by both sides, potentially sometime within the next 48 hours. Does that surprise you?
A little bit, but hey, let's face it. This has been an incredible relationship agreement for a long time. It's been good for everybody. It's been good for the league, rights holders, players, retired players. I know it's not perfect. No deal ever is, but if there's reasonable minds in a room and they can figure out a way to keep growing the pie for everybody, then let's keep this thing going. And I think it speaks to the relationship that Roger Goodell and Dee Smith have. And maybe publicly people have their own opinions, but obviously two guys that are very smart, hardworking, and obviously have a lot of respect for one another.
Everyone knows there's a lot of money on the table for this. I understand all that. Most of the public beef that we see has to do with punishment. Roger Goodell obviously has a ton of power when it comes to being able to punish players, and so that can create some awkward situations. But everyone knows there's a lot of money at stake. I think the thing you mentioned, it's the continued push for health care and the care for current and former players in a lot of this. It's probably the sticking point, which is understandable.
That's right, and I think we all have responsibilities and guardians of the game and make sure that we recognize and take care of the players that have made this game so great for all of us.
All right, so the one buy instead of two buys, how do you think that will affect teams?
Yeah, I've been very fortunate to be part of three teams that have gone to the championship game, and I will tell you, at that time of year, guys, health and home field advantage are important. It's meaningful. And you said earlier, Trey, about I think it was the Ravens was the last three seed to go
right
to the Super Bowl. That's not by accident, guys. To have only one buy, that will give that one team a huge advantage for two reasons. They're going to be more rested, and they're playing at home. And just to pick a team, Kansas City, if they get home field advantage and they're the only team that doesn't have a bye, just pencil in Patrick Mahomes for the next four or five Super Bowls if this really comes to
fruition. I'm pretty much okay with that.
But I think that's a good point to make because so many people are stuck on this and saying, more teams, more competitive, more opportunities right for my team. Like, no, we're just really making it easier for the really good team to already have who already has a leg up in that situation to get even further.
I mean, think about like the NFC, Philly, San Francisco, Green Bay, New Orleans. Those teams, plus or minus, are within a couple of percentage points of one another. The one team that doesn't have to play an extra game and play at home, they have a huge advantage over the rest of them.
Right. That's why the one thing I have concern about that, we had one 13-3 team in the NFC play on wildcard weekend. Under this format, this year we would have had two.
That's right.
And so that is the one thing, if I'm a CEO or a GM of one of those teams, like, I need to be rewarded for what we just did.
And if I'm Roger Goodell, what I tell you, Mr. CEO, go win in the regular season because it's going to matter. And now that's going to hopefully increase traffic to your stadium. And that's why our sport's so good. Every game matters.
Okay. 17-game schedule. As a GM, how does this change how you think about things?
Yeah, I'm not happy with that as a GM because now things like load management, you really got to start thinking about, like, roughly, let's say there's 1,000 offensive plays, and let's just take New Orleans, for example. If I'm managing Drew Brees, maybe I'm playing 600 or 700 of those snaps. You know, Mike Greenberg on Get Up the last couple of days, he was pushing that whole idea of, like, hey, does Drew Brees start splitting snaps with Taysom Hill? I think those are the conversations you're going to have is, can Taysom Hill take 300-400 snaps at quarterback? Because you want to have Drew Brees ready to go in the stretch run.
So, I mean, would you want an expanded roster in this situation? Because that's, to me, if I'm the players, this is the one chip we have. Like, you need us to sign off on this. I'm trying to get everything.
Yeah, I think what's interesting is maybe, obviously you want more players, but maybe more liberalized rules in terms of injured reserve, players coming on and off the roster. Because we have tweaked those rules over the years when I was on the GM committee. But let's face it, sometimes rehab things are accelerated, things are delayed. You don't know. So the more flexibility you could have coming down the stretch, like someone like J.J. Watt, he came back maybe somewhat unexpected. So, Trey, to answer your question, I want as much flexibility as possible, either more players or the ability to bring some more back.
Yeah, Quan Alexander, too, also came back somewhat unexpectedly for the 49ers.
Yeah, great call.
Okay, hold on. Bill Belichick conversations, assuming this is about what he's trying to do with quarterback?
100%. To me, the most fascinating thing in the offseason, and I've been around Coach Belichick a couple of times, is what happens when he's faced with this decision. Tom Brady and his family has moved to City X, Nashville, L.A., New York. He needs every Monday off, and as just to remind the viewers, NFL, most teams have Tuesdays off. So would Bill Belichick want Tom Brady 4 days a week, or would he want Andy Dalton 6 days a week, Ryan Tannehill, Teddy Bridgewater, fill in the blank quarterback? And to me, that conversation is the most fascinating one. Would he take Tom Brady back with conditions the way we took Brett Favre at the New York Jets going back a number of years, or is it unconditional? And that, to me, that conversation of all the ones going on in the NFL is the one I love to listen in on.
How difficult was dealing with that? How difficult was that for our coaching staff to try and put together all the things with the guy you need in the middle of it there one last day?
Yeah, our calculation, Mike, on that was simply, hey, we have a chance to get Brett Favre, and we love Chad Pennington, but we can't go beat Tom Brady and the New England Patriots. They're better at quarterback. Brett Favre gives us a chance to compete, and if he needs an extra day off, let's give him the materials he needs to study the game plan, rehab, whatever it needs to be to have him out of the building on Monday. So that calculus is only one that Bill Belichick can make, and I think it's a fascinating one because, you know, Bill stands for a lot. You know, the rules are the rules and the standards are the standards, but if it comes down to Tom Brady 4 days a week or quarterback X 6 days a week, let's see what he does.
Boy, that's interesting.
And what's interesting is they're coming at from the opposite side that you guys were. Hey, we've got the guy that we think we can win with, but we're deciding if he's worth it with those stipulations versus some change that could be better or worse.
Hey, guys, what about the other side of that conversation? I'm Tom Brady. I know this offense.
Yeah.
Like, if I'm just going to be getting, you know, ice and stim, and I could do that in New York, why do I have to be in Foxborough?
That's a great question. I mean, like, if I'm Tom Brady, I'm flexing for that as much as I possibly can. All right, you think the draft starts in Detroit with the third overall selection?
100%. Everyone says the draft is in Vegas. This year's draft is in Detroit, Michigan, guys. We know Burrow's going
to I need to change my plans.
I'm still going to Vegas. I want that very clear.
I thought you were going to Africa.
I am going to there Friday, but then when I get back, I'm going to Vegas also. So okay, busy couple of weeks.
Yeah, I got you. Well, here's why. Burrow is Cincinnati, Chase Young in Washington. Let's just put those to bed. Here's the interesting conversation, and I've been in their seats. You're Bob Quinn, you're trying to hold on to your job. You're Matt Patricia, you're trying to hold on to your job. You have a good quarterback in Matt Stafford. You were 3-4-1 before he got hurt. You lost two games to Kansas City and Green Bay by a total of 5 points. Now you have a guy in Tua Tagovailoa who could be Drew Brees, who could be Aaron Rodgers. If you're running that franchise and saying, what's best for us for the next 10 years, you take Tua, you turn the card,
right. You
never look back. However, if I'm Bob Quinn and Matt Patricia, I'm like, hold on a second. I don't care about 10 years. I care about where we're going to be in 10 minutes. I'm taking Jeff Okuda.
Well, the interesting – the cornerback out of Ohio State. The interesting thing there is, to me, I feel like if they go down the tool road, that tells me Quinn feels like he's on sturdier ground than Matt Patricia is, right?
Great point.
Right? Because if he's getting the okay to do that, it sounds to me like as a general manager, hey, you're good, but Matt was sort of already by the way, we're going to give this thing one more year here.
Yeah, but now imagine if you're Bob Quinn and you're walking into Matt Patricia's office and now like, hey, we're in this together.
Yeah.
But we got to
you bet.
Yeah.
Sure we are.
We're in this together.
In the great words of the ancient Greek philosopher Rex Ryan, you know, Mike, win or win, that guy's with us every step of the way.
There you go. Exactly. What's the next one? How Philly could rip Jerry's heart out.
Ooh.
I'm interested.
Oh, are you?
So if you're the Philadelphia Eagles and you have Alshon Jeffrey on this side and you have DeSean Jackson on this side, and you have an opportunity to add one more receiver because Nelson Aguilar won't be there, and there's someone named Amari Cooper of the Dallas Cowboys, you could greatly improve your team. Imagine Amari Cooper with Carson Wentz, Zach Ertz, and everybody else, and hurt and cripple Dallas, who just gave up a first-round pick. Yeah. And by the way, Dallas has been number one in third-down conversion since that Amari Cooper trade. That would rip Jerry Jones's heart out.
Yeah,
I can say, and Jerry's busy doing the other contract that he should have done a long time ago, like the Amari Cooper one. I remember we had that conversation with
guys,
you.
Guys, Jerry Jones made two mistakes. He made it strategically where he signed the wrong players first.
Inside linebacker.
Yeah, Jalen Smith, Lyle Collins, Demarcus Lawrence, good football players.
Zeke Elliott.
Should have waited. So mistake number one was not signing Prescott and a guy you gave up a first-round pick, and secondly, you rewarded Zeke Elliott going to Mexico.
Yeah.
And you're saying that behavior is okay.
All right, last one. Tua's medical report will be.
Okay.
So far, it's been good, right?
Yeah, but this is based on going to medical school for 20-plus years in Indy, and I guarantee you what's going to come out of that, and this is what's very frustrating from a team perspective, is 75% of the doctors are going to say, you know what, things look good, and unless there's a bump in the road in rehab, he'll be okay. Well, wait, take a stand. There'll be two or three outliers that will say he's off our board, and I promise you could carve this in concrete. The agent will come out and say he got flying colors. The medical people were just absolutely pleasantly surprised how good it looks, and you've never heard an agent say that the medical report didn't, and that's based on 20 years of a doctorate earned in Indy.
Well, listen, as they always say, oh, he had successful surgery. They never say, yeah, it didn't really work out the way we thought.
It's funny.
You're waiting for that one.
You know, Trey, yeah. I always pressed our doctors on that, and they would always say, hey, quietly, hey, Mike, you know, in medical school, the answer to that is when the patient doesn't wake up.
Then it's unsuccessful.
Then it's not a successful surgery.
Yeah.
A doctorate from Lucas Oil U.
There you go. Yeah, yeah. A lot of people get doctorates there, so we'll find out what happens at the Combine. Mike, always good to see you. Coming up, why 84 is the magic number for the Astros, and it has nothing to do with a win total. We'll get to that next. Golic and Wingo, ESPN Radio, ESPN2.